Hi guys, welcome to a new episode of our series History of the Church. Today we are going to talk about our beloved Coptic Church. But in the beginning, we are going to reveal the history behind the word Copt or Coptic. The word Copt or Coptic has been added to the English language recently in the 17th century, and actually it was driven from the new Latin word Coptus, which is originally as well driven from the Arabic word Qibt. The Coptic word in turn is an adaptation of the Greek word Egyptos, which means Egyptian. The Greek word of Egypt, which is Egyptos itself, is driven from the ancient Egyptian word Hut Ka Ptah, which means the house or the state of the spirit of God Ptah, which was the name of a temple existing in the city of Memphis in ancient Egypt. While in Coptic language, the Copts refer to themselves as Remenkini, which literally means the people of Egypt. Also in Arabic, we say about Egypt, Misr. And Misr is coming from the name of Mizraim, the son of Ham, the son of Noah, which is mentioned in Genesis chapter 10, that he dwelt in Egypt. Now we move to talk about Christianity and Egypt. We all know that St. Mark the Apostle was the one who came and preached the gospel to the Egyptians in the first century. But also there were many other references to Christianity before and after St. Mark in the first century. For example, the book of Acts in chapter 2 and verse 10 in the day of the Pentecost refers to a group of Jews were attending the sermon of St. Peter in Jerusalem in the day of the Pentecost. So for sure, those people returned back to Egypt with the idea of Christianity. Also, the book of Acts mentions an Alexandrian Jew named Apollos, who demonstrated from scriptures that Jesus is the coming Christ, and this is mentioned in the book of Acts chapter 18. Also, St. Luke addresses his gospel to an Alexandrian person named Theophilus, and this is mentioned in the Gospel of St. Luke chapter 1 and verse 3. Also in our Coptic Synaxarium on the day of 15 Bashans records that St. Simon Zealot preached the gospel in Upper Egypt and in Nubia. So these previous references indicate that Christianity found its way in Egypt even before St. Mark the Apostle. The famous historian Herodotus said about ancient Egyptians that Egyptians are religious to excess far beyond any other race of men. And we can say that the following four factors helped Christianity to find its way in Egypt and to be accepted widely by the Egyptians. The first factor is the religious background of the ancient Egyptians. We all know that ancient Egyptians believed in life after death. The second factor is the scientific background of the ancient Egyptians. They were great in science, but also all their science abilities were used to serve their religious ideas. For example, the Great Pyramids. With all the mysteries of the pyramids, they were at the end tombs or graves, prepared and ready to receive the kings after they come to life again. The third factor is the religious dogmas of the ancient Egyptians. We all know as well that ancient Egyptians, before many of the other nations, managed to reach the idea of worshipping one god in the era of King Akhenaton. And finally, they had their form of the cross, which is called Ankh, or the key of life. This key of life was usually drawn, held by the immortals for ancient Egyptians, between brackets, the kings or the pharaohs and the gods. And for sure, this key of life or Ankh is the form of the cross in Christianity, or resembles the form of the cross in Christianity. let's take a quick review on the incidents that the Copts lived before the Council of Chalcedon. For example, in the year 49 AD, St. Mark arrived to Alexandria, and then he established famous Alexandrian theological school, and he was martyred in the year 68 AD. Later on, in the year 189 or 190, the Easter day calculation was done in Egypt in the era of Saint Demetrius the Vine Dresser, and was sent all over the world each year in the festal letter, so everyone can know when to celebrate Easter. Later on in the year 190 as well, the Alexandria School of Theology was revived, and between the year 249 and 259, Saint Paul the Hermit went into the desert, starting a new way of life. Later on in the year 271, as well, Saint Anthony went to the desert, starting the kind of monastic life that is widely known as of today. In between the years 303 and 311, the Egyptians also suffered from the great persecution. And in the year 318, Saint Petronius started another way of monastic life, which is the Cenobite monasticism, which is also commonly known worldwide today. In the year 341 AD, Saint Frumentius was ordained as the first bishop of Ethiopia by Saint Athanasius the Apostolic. In the year 367 AD, Saint Athanasius as well, in one of his festal letters, sent the New Testament canon, which contains the whole 27 books of the New Testament that we know today. In the year 381, there was the Council of Constantinople, and in the year 431, there was the Council of Ephesus. After the Council of Chalcedon, and due to the division of the church to Chalcedonians and non-Chalcedonians, a new term appeared in Egypt and the Middle East, which is the term Melkite. This term pointed to the Chalcedonians and their patriarch in Alexandria, which was usually appointed by the Byzantine emperor. Moreover, the Copts lived in several decades of tensions and tribulations, persecution, exiling of patriarchs, and closing of the churches, and they refused to obey any of the Chalcedonian creeds. And by the end of the 6th century, this kind of persecution reached a high level, as the Copts were totally removed from all government positions. It is also worth mentioning that the Coptic Synaxarium that we have today was collected in the 6th century by Saint John, the Bishop of Brolos. And after the Council of Chalcedon until the Islamic conquest of Egypt, we had 13 patriarchs who led the church in Egypt in many different difficult periods. In times of rest, the Coptic Church also faced some internal heresies after the Council of Chalcedon. I will mention only two of them, for example. The first heresy was called the Divine Quadrant. It appeared in the era of Pope Damian, the 35th of Alexandria, as some people preached that the three persons of God has a fourth general existence. This heresy was fought by Saint Jacob Beredeus, the Bishop of Odessa, and he managed to restore the faith of Saint Dioscorus and the Church Fathers. The other issue was actually a debate on the Trisagion. We know the Trisagion, we praise it in every liturgy, when we say, Holy God, Holy Mighty, Holy Immortal, who was born of the Virgin, have mercy upon us. Historically, this praise was heard by Saint Joseph of Arimathea while he was burying the Lord. And also, later on, it was organized by Saint Peter the Apostle to be praised before the reading of the Gospel in the liturgy. During the 6th century, some people claimed that it should not be used in the liturgy because they claimed that the divine cannot suffer. The heresy was fought by the Coptic Church, explaining that the praise actually was directed to the incarnated Son, who was born and crucified and raised from the dead for our sake. And this praise was not by any means directed to the Holy Trinity. These are more references if you want to dig deeper on the topics that we cover today in our episode. Thank you for watching. See you in the next episode. Pray for me. Bye.